please welcome back to the stage, Alex.
Welcome back. Hope you had a good lunch. So hopefully you had an interesting time kind of trying out these products and basically having, you know, AI apply to your own industry and being able to play around with that. We thought it'd be interesting for you to see how these AI technologies are also currently impacting others, other industries around us that we might not work in day to day. And so that's what this next talk is going to be about. So we're going to momentarily welcome Nathan, Benaich, and YihKai Teh to the stage. Just to give you a bit of background, Nathan Benaich was one of our first ever investors. He's got a combined interest in artificial intelligence, but also has a PhD in I believe, bioinformatics at Cambridge. And he's also the author of the State of AI report, which is a very in-depth report on how AI is impacting, you know, not only industry, but also research, as well as academia, regulation, and education. And it's really, really emerging as the authority on allowing people to just track progress. And he'll be joined with YihKai. YihKai is basically a bit of a celebrity within Tractable. And I think you're going to quickly, from his laugh, his mannerisms, and what he's got cooked up for you together with Nathan, you'll quickly understand why. So please welcome on stage Nathan and YihKai.
Perfect. Thank you so much, Alex. Thanks to everybody for sticking around after the coffee break and lunch. It's a huge pleasure to be here and continue on this journey of exploring what machine learning can do within insurance and financial technology, but also in other industries. As Alex described, I'm Nathan Benaich. I run a venture fund investing in AI companies. I'm joined by YihKai, who's lead researcher at Tractable, and is one of the many people taking these breakthroughs in academic labs and making them into real products that everybody can use. And so in 25 minutes or so, we'll breeze through a couple of select bite-size features on what machine learning is doing in different industries, ranging from fintech, healthcare, and perhaps even nuclear fusion.
Cool. Thanks a lot, Nathan. World-changing AI. What an exciting topic to be talking about it today. So I'm not sure, do you guys know, but AI actually was created as early as 1956, right? But it's only the last 10 years when it absolutely took off. And the reason is mainly boiled down to large amount of data and huge amount of computational power, right? So working in this really exciting field, every day I get to witness the amazing progress AI make. Until today, it still amazes me, right? Until today, it still amazes me. So I'm sure you guys probably have heard this before, that AI really is impacting all parts of society. But the truth is, it really is, right? But before, in order to truly grasp the magnitude of what this means, first, we need to understand the meaning of society, right? So society, the first society, first appeared in the Mesopotamia. And it was characterized by a few elements, ranging from things like science, art, human interaction, food, safety, languages, medicine, and obviously history as well, right? And so you will see that, like, now you see society laid out in front of you. Does AI really impact them all? You'll be surprised. Let us walk you through it.
So to start, let's look at probably one of the most fascinating problems that affect all of us at some point in our lives. And that's the question of developing new medicines. In the last 2 years, it's become abundantly clear that we need to find much better drugs for a variety of diseases a lot faster than what exists today. To give you a snapshot of what's required to bring a medicine into the clinic, one stat is it takes over $1 billion of research and development and clinical trial money to actually figure out if a drug even works. And that's over a decade time span. And why is that? One of the obvious reasons as a biologist is just biology is hard. We have to somehow uncode how these complex systems work, and sometimes we get it right, sometimes we get it wrong. And zooming in a little bit, one of the reasons why biology is hard is that it's a mechanistic system with lots of little small components that need to work together perfectly. And one of those components are proteins. These are basically the cellular machinery that makes everything work. One important thing to know about proteins is it's their structure, their kind of 3D shape that dictates how they work. But figuring out the 3D shape of a protein is incredibly expensive and takes a ton of time. You essentially have to use a very complex, expensive microscope and run very small experiments to figure it out. Here I'm showing you a graph of an academic competition which tries to predict the 3D structure of a protein from purely its alphabetical sequence using computers. And you can see that basically the performance of this competition on an annual basis has stayed roughly stagnant. But there's been a breakthrough in the last 2 years, and that's really applying deep learning to the problem of protein structure prediction. A London-based company called DeepMind published a product called AlphaFold, which is now state-of-the-art in predicting 3D structure from purely sequence. This is the result from 2018 and the result from 2 years ago, almost blitzing previous methods. To give you a kind of a real sense of what this looks like, here's an example of a green experimental result of what a 3D structure looks like and the blue one from a computer. The TLDR is they look almost the same. So what can you actually use this for? One major thing is to use this 3D structure to see how many different drugs might bind to that structure. And the drugs that bind the best are probably the ones that you should advance into clinical trials. So to illustrate this a bit better, there's a UK-based company called Exscientia, which is using technologies like this in machine learning to design much better drugs, to predict how they might bind to 3D structures of proteins, and to only test those drugs that look really promising in software in the real world. And this translates to, for example, seeing that Exscientia tests 10 times fewer compounds in the real world than industry peers and pharmaceutical companies. So this means that they can advance better drugs much faster into clinical studies, wasting fewer human life in the process, of course, and taking a lot less time and money.
Cool. So now let's imagine a world where if you can describe it, you can create it. That sounds pretty powerful, right? Well, that is exactly what happened back in 2020. A company by the name of like OpenAI, which is a San Francisco startup co-founded by Elon Musk, released an AI called GPT-3, right? So this GPT-3 can create a human-like text. What does this mean? You probably have seen a glimpse of this in the morning from Alex's keynote, but the way to imagine this is like, just imagine an AI that can write pretty much anything. You feed in a poem of a poet you like, and it will be able to generate a new one in the same rhythm and the same genre. It can write an article. It can create friction. It can even read an article, allow you to ask questions for it, and then summarize it for you, right? And it can even write computer languages. So all of these things is actually not new by itself, but the ability to do all of this under one algorithm, this is pretty impressive. And because of how incredible this AI is, and language understanding, since its release, people have tried to take it further, right? Try to go further. And one of them is actually called DALL-E 2. So this actually only released 2 weeks ago, right? 2 weeks ago. You also see a prelims of this one this morning from Alex, where a tutu walking a dog. So DALL-E 2 basically are trained on millions of images along with your text as well. So right now what it can do is anything you can type, it will be able to understand what you mean and generate for you. For example, have you ever seen a polar bear playing bass? Or a koala dunking a basketball? How about an astronaut riding a horse in space? All of these things is not real, right? They exist in someone else's imagination. And that is what makes it so powerful, right? And I think it's really pretty cool to think about this, that like, this could really help people to express visually in ways that we could not have before and help us to amplify our creative potential. Okay, so enough talk. Since this GPT-3 is so amazing, let's just take it for a spin and let's do a quick demo. Cool. So here is like a live GPT-3. To set the scene off, I will start typing something that I think maybe could be quite cool. So since we are all here from automotive, right, we care a lot about car, let's try to ask GPT-3 to like write a car damage report in a Shakespeare sonnet, right? Let's see what it came up with. So right now, what the AI right now is doing is that like it's thinking, generating. Let's see what other amazing thing it came up with, right? So let's see. So, okay, it's generating quite a lot. Let's read through some of them. So my car was damaged, but unfortunately not total. The other driver was at fault, and their insurance should pay. But of course, they are going to give me the runaway and try to wheeze out of pain. This is the story of my car damage. It happened last week on Tuesday. I was driving down the street, and another car came out of nowhere and just smashed into the side of my car. The damage isn't too bad, but it would cost a few hundred to fix it. The other driver was at fault, and their insurance should pay. But of course, they are going to try me to give me a... So you know, you can see that like it's starting to like repeat itself. I'm just glad that I wasn't hurt, and my car wasn't total, but dealing with the insurance company is going to be a nightmare. So this is the live AI, right? And obviously, we can write anything, right? We can even ask them to regenerate the same thing of it and see how it feels. But I will see, is there any suggestion you guys want to do? Otherwise, I will ask them to generate one more time. What do you guys think? Any suggestion that you guys want to ask them to write it down? If not, then let's try one more time. So we'll delete it, and then let's see. But not always you'll be able to generate something nice. So right now, this is a little bit different and a little bit shorter. So my car was damaged in the hit and run. The other car didn't even stop. My front fender crumbled, and my paint is scratched. The headlight busted, and my bumper dented. The insurer will cover for the repair, but I will never forget the way I felt. When I saw my car damaged and alone, the victim was some careless jerk. So that is GPT-3. Back over to Nathan.
That's pretty hard to match. Okay, so shifting over to another topic. What we've really seen over the last 12 months is you know, these kinds of toy demos, which look really exciting. But actually, AI is making its way into pretty high-stakes environments where if you get things wrong, it's really, really important not to get them wrong. And one of those examples is workplace safety. So this is the problem of, you know, industrial companies, manufacturing businesses, utility companies, which have thousands and thousands of workers operating in highly complex and sometimes dangerous environments where they might be manipulating heavy machinery or working along one another and vehicles. And it turns out that, unfortunately, every 7 seconds, somebody is injured on the job. This might happen because they slip over something left on the floor, or perhaps they're caught monkey climbing on a warehouse shelf to fetch something that's out of reach. So you can imagine that trying to figure out exactly what's happening 24/7 across an entire facility footprint with thousands of employees is just not possible in human time. So what can machine learning do here? So it turns out that you can actually connect. Let's see if this will play. No. There are actually facilities that have connected cameras. And those cameras are filming the indoor environments all the time. And they're pretty much underused. So we can actually just replace the policies that health and safety inspectors are using on kind of manual inspections and implement them into computer vision rules, so that the cameras are effectively 24/7 health and safety operatives. In this demo here, which is unfortunately not playing, the camera is actually detecting the posture of employees as they're manipulating objects and effectively detecting when they're doing certain gestures which are unsafe. As you can see here, someone is picking up something and not bending their knees and will eventually probably lead to some back pain. The result of this is actually already proven to see less injuries through alerting, and much more kind of safe work environments through surveys with employees. And most importantly, the companies that install this solution actually see better insurance premiums because they produce safer work environments. And we're seeing this across some major companies, across consumer goods, and manufacturing globally.
Cool. So throughout history, there has been a lot of amazing historical figure that people look up to, right? However, due to the limited technology that exists in their lifetime, they just have very limited material remaining on how do they look or even how do they feel, right? Except maybe sometimes we have like some black and white photo about them. Have you ever wondered what would they look like if they are still live today? So a few years ago, there is an amazing AI technique called Generative Adversarial Network, or this is GAN, which is capable of doing amazing image generation. It can do wonder, right? And one of those wonder is to be able to bring this historical figure back to life. For example, what might Abraham Lincoln or Thomas Edison look like today? Well, we all have seen the black and white photo about them, right? So which looks something like this. And using this form of AI, we will be able to restore the quality of any Asian photo into something that looked like is captured by our camera today. Will be something like this, right? So it basically will, it could very much easily be treated as something that looked like today. However, we actually don't really need to just stop at here. We don't need to stop at like color restoration. We can even animate them back to life, right? Wow, I always wonder what Abraham Lincoln looked like when he smiled. Well, now I know. So of course, you don't really need to just do this on like historical figure. You can do it even on your ancestor as well, right? There's actually a company that can help you to do that, which is called like MyHeritage. And you'll definitely have a wow moment when you see one of your most treasured family photo that have been in your family for generations just appear right in front of you. It just gives you a new profound way to connect back to your family history. And that's about like generative adversarial network. Next.
Another aspect that I guess we've really seen our lives change in the last 2 years is now, if we can buy something online, I think we'd overall just prefer to do that. But while it's really easy for the customer to just place an order online and get a product in an hour, in a day at a doorstep, for the retailer, it's a huge pain. And that's really just because predicting consumer behavior and understanding what product to stock and when and where is extremely difficult. Today, there are entire category management teams that try and make these forecasting decisions on their own. But with constantly changing consumer behavior, adapting to these changes is just too difficult. The result is really this problem of stock replenishment, which is the idea that if you stock too little and your customers have more demand than what you can fulfill, they're pretty unhappy. But if you stock too much, then you're going to waste product and your margins will erode. So what can you use machine learning for here? In the UK, there's a company called Ocado Technology, which is one of the leading companies doing online commerce and online groceries. And they're pretty famous for implementing robotics, machine learning, and automation in as many circumstances as they can. And one of the most fascinating applications of this is in the stock replenishment problem, where they've taken historical data for every single product that they have listed on their website and partner websites, and the historical trends of consumer demand and what might influence consumer demand in the future, and trained a machine learning system to effectively make these stock replenishment decisions automatically. And what they've been able to do is forecast these decisions for 98% of their products. And this is deployed across all their major customers, which means no more manual forecasting in Excel, just a software system that's continually adapting to how consumer preferences might change depending on the environment we're in. And this even extends far beyond replenishing, where they're also using machine learning for pick and place and for navigating across complex indoor environments with these parcels so that we can get our orders in much more timely fashion.
Cool. So I'm sure all of us here have been stuck in a call before, right? Either calling for reservation, appointment, or even just customer services. So I know it's a really painful and unpleasant experience, right? Because like recently, one of my flights was canceled one day before, and I was stuck in an hour just with the airline customer service, right? For waiting for clarification. What a waste of my time. But maybe this might not last for long. What if instead of you being stuck in the call, what if the AI could take the call for you, right? So a few years ago, Google released an AI called Duplex. And what this Duplex can do is it can make any reservation, an appointment for you. And here is like a real clip that released by Google a few years ago where they are calling a hair salon. And let's have a listen.
How can I help you? Hi, I'm calling to book a woman's haircut for a client. I'm looking for something on May 3rd.
Sure, give me 1 second.
Mm-hmm.
Sure, what time are you looking for around?
At 12 p.m.
We do not have a 12 p.m. available. The closest we have to that is a 1:15.
Do you have anything between 10 a.m. and 12 p.m.?
Depending on what service she would like, what service is she looking for?
Just a woman's haircut for now.
Okay, we have a 10 o'clock.
10 a.m. is fine.
Okay, what's her first name?
The first name is Lisa.
Okay, perfect. So I will see Lisa at 10 o'clock on May 3rd.
Okay, great. Thanks.
Great. Have a great day. Bye.
Cool. So this is AI talking to a human, right? They are helping you to make an appointment. That is pretty incredible, right? So, but wait, maybe you might ask that like, could that be possible be another AI on the other side of the line as well? Well, the answer is yes. So there could really be another AI on the other side as well. So in London, there is a startup called PolyAI who have been basically working on automating customer service for businesses. Today, they are live taking call from the customer in the UK and US. For example, just helping hospital to provide guidance to like COVID-19, right? Some of the customers that they work with ranges from like BP, FedEx, Marriott, and Starling Bank as well. And I know what you guys are thinking about, right? Can they both talk to each other? What happens if they don't talk to each other? Well, let's have another listen.
We have now reopened. I'm a digital host. I can make bookings or tell you what we're doing to keep our guests safe. How can I help?
I'm calling from Google Maps. Given the current health situation, I want to update if you're open today. I'm an automated service, so this call is monitored and recorded for quality assurance. When do you open and close today?
Today, we are open for breakfast between 6:30 and 10:30 a.m. We are open for lunch and dinner between 12 and 9:30 p.m.
Sorry, so you'll be open from 10:30 a.m. to 9:30 p.m., right? Okay.
When would you like to come in?
Thank you for your time. I actually was just calling about the opening hours, but thanks a lot for your help, and have a great day.
Wow. So this is two AI talking to each other. They're not human, right? So what a world we are living in today. Crazy. Right? Google Duplex really does sound like a human. If it wasn't mentioned they are an automated service, I probably would have believed it's a human. So moving on.
Smooth transition to energy independence. So one of the problems that I've seen more and more entrepreneurs working on is climate change. They're really just trying to ensure that we're not burning petrochemicals into perpetuity, and instead that we figure out much cleaner sources of energy. One of the holy grails in energy generation is this concept of nuclear fusion, which is really how the stars in the galaxy power themselves. Now, in these stars and in the sun, you have basically very high power molecules in there that are circulating at incredibly high speeds, some say 150 million degrees Celsius, and they're smashing into each other constantly. And when they smash into each other, they release immense amounts of energy. So the question becomes, can we try and reproduce this sort of chemical reaction, this sort of physical concept on planet Earth and do so safely? And so that's where designs like this come in, which is essentially a donut-looking structure, which is incredibly complex and tries to reproduce this reaction, where you have gas that's called plasma that's circulating these electrons around in very, very high speeds and trying to control it with an immensely powerful magnet and doing this in a way that makes sure it doesn't blow up. And so to control this reaction, you know, physics engineers need to do essentially very complex knob tuning, trying to set all the different parameters in this physical instrument to keep it safe and generating energy. So could we use machine learning for this problem of knob tuning and control? And it turns out that yes. Only a few weeks ago, DeepMind, again in London, in collaboration with the Swiss University, actually deployed some of the similar machine learning systems that they've been using to control video game systems, which, you know, a couple years ago we just looked at as a toy, as something that might not be useful in the real world, and actually demonstrated that they can take these similar principles and have this system learn how to control a nuclear fusion reactor, which is pretty mind-blowing to just see the immense progress that's been made over the last couple years. And it's just one more incremental step towards a realistic future of clean energy with fusion.
Cool. So, all right, now that we have covered all elements of society, right, do you understand what I said in the beginning, that AI really do impact all part of our society? It is a really interesting thought to think about, like society is actually constructed by human, and but is slowly becoming more and more influenced by this artificial world, right? Then it begs the question, can we both coexist peacefully? Well, if you ask me, so this actually very much depending on like how humans perceive AI as AI grow in its capability and impact. And there's actually a concept called the uncanny valley that tries to describe this, right? So if you kind of make like graph 101, right? Everyone know who graph 101. So like you plot in the vertical axis human reaction from the very positive all the way to the very negative, right? And then on the horizontal axis, you plot like how human-like the machine look like, ranging from zero thought all the way to it just look exactly like a human, right? And when if you plot this, then what you will be able to see is that like a graph that's slowly increasing something like this. So what does this mean? This means that like actually as robot becoming more and more like human, we're actually feeling very positive about it, right? Slowly increasing. For example, so we have like all this, we started with having all this industrial robot, right? We are pretty happy with like what they can do, but don't feel so strongly emotional attached to it, right? But as it becomes better, it will be something like this. So this one of Star Wars favorite, like recently favorite called BB-8, everyone, okay, many people like them, right? So you can see the idea of like as you grow better and better, people, human feel much better about it. But however, if you constantly keep increasing it, you will actually, human will starting to grow more cautious, maybe even resentful about their existence, right? And this is actually something that is called as the uncanny valley. So, for example, one example of this one would be like, if you guys have seen like Ex Machina is pretty crazy of the amazing thing they can do, it really makes you wonder that like, okay, I should be more cautious about this. But what is really interesting is that like once you pass that certain point, you can actually starting to develop empathy toward it, right? And you can starting to feel more positive toward their existence and all our coexistence. So what does this mean? Does your AI either have to be really convincing or not convincing at all? What do you think Tractable AI lies in this spectrum? Maybe depending on the user, either like it's coming from like a policyholder or a repairer or insurer, you might place it differently along this axis, right? So that is something to think about.
So to wrap up and bring us back to the here and now, I hope that through this presentation, you've seen such a wide variety of use cases of machine learning, and we tried to make it as tangible as possible. And if we look at some of the largest technology organizations in the world that have really just defined public markets and defined the way that we interact with products in our daily lives, it's abundantly clear that they both, and pretty much all of them, think that machine learning is a core engine of their business. Whether it's Google thinking about how machine learning can transform all of their products, from Google Photos, Gmail, Maps, and more, to Amazon, which also has been building internal machine learning systems for its own use case, and externalizing all of this through their web platform, AWS. And it's really not just these big major technology companies that are embracing machine learning and transforming businesses with it. As you've seen abundantly today, it's also small companies that didn't exist 10 years ago that are really trailblazing. And big companies, Tractable, we're not alone. There are companies across biotechnology, big financial institutions, clothing companies, cybersecurity businesses, PC companies, you know, apps that the millennials like using these days, and even auto traders that are making use of machine learning. So really, the whole reason that we're here is that AI, we think, and increasingly is demonstrated to redefine enterprise value and allows these companies to really compete in an increasingly competitive marketplace. So with that, thank you very much for your attention. And we have a couple of minutes for some questions in case anybody wants to dig in a bit further. So thank you all very much. Any questions? Is Fran at the back?
Great talk. Thanks a lot. So you spoke a lot about a whole bunch of different AI technologies. Maybe this is one question, maybe it's two. Which one are you most excited about, and which one do you think is going to have the biggest impact on society in the next, say, 5 years?
I'd have to pick computer vision, just because there are just so many use cases everywhere that we look that I think can be just rethought with this technology, whether it's, you know, automating document processing, or, you know, recognizing objects in our phones when we're trying to search for loved ones or places that we've been in Google Photos, or even applications like Tractable or in health and safety, or even in biology with drug discovery. So I think that's probably the most powerful technology, followed closely by machines that can read and generate text. I think these are the two areas to really pay attention to that have huge ramifications.